The Philippine Stock Exchange begins trading at 60.15, up 0.3% this morning. Joining us now for his take on the markets, Miguel Agarao of Philequity. Hi, Miguel. Good morning.
Good morning, Mimi.
Good morning. Great morning, ha? So let's start with AREITs. Historic day.
Okay. Well, AREITs actually like a big chunk of the market volume today. Mm-hmm. It opened flat, trying for green, but it looks okay. It's stable at its opening price. Mm-hmm. Which is the same as its listing price,
which is 27 pesos per share.
Yeah.
Do you
so
think
it's sitting there?
Do you think this excitement for the country's first REIT is going to be sustained?
Well, what I can tell you is, if you're a foreign investor and interest rates there are practically zero, I mean, this provides yield of between 4.5% to 5%. It gives a good alternative to that. In this yield-starved environment, many investors, especially those who like to play safe and are just yield seekers, mm-hmm. they're looking for instruments like AREIT.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let's look at the big picture now, Miguel. In terms of the traditional balance in portfolio, are we still using the traditional mix of portfolio, considering the way that the bond market is doing now, how equities are doing? I mean, how do you diversify in a way to get the risk-adjusted returns in light of extraordinary monetary policy in this pandemic environment?
Well, I'm not necessarily the best person to ask because I'm a 99% equity guy. But, and I have the traditional portfolio with 60-40.
Okay.
Well, in this environment, if there's no more yield, I mean, you have to start looking at how I'd say riskier instruments. So either you go for bonds with higher yield, which may or may not be a good thing, depending on their quality. You can also increase equity exposure in your portfolio because with markets falling a lot, like, example, the Philippines, which is down still significantly year to date. Just on capital gains, there's significant upside if you stretch it over a 5-year basis. You can also put stocks with good dividend yields. You have like AREIT, your PLDT, which can provide your yield significantly above inflation.
Mm-hmm.
So you can just like mix your portfolio that way.
Mm-hmm. But you know, when you look at your expectations for future returns, are they falling as well?
Well, it's hard to say what that exact number is, but at least if you're looking for next year, with stocks down this much, unless COVID mutates into a three-headed hydra or something, mm-hmm. I mean, there should be more upside. There should be significant upside next year. And if you look at it from the perspective of low interest rates, if interest rates are so low and you're looking for yield, where will that money go?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's going to go into equities.
But Miguel, you know, for those who are looking at the market, they're saying, you know, did I miss the train? Did I miss the big sale already? Because it seems like this market is fighting. This market is fighting to go higher.
You missed part of the big sale. So if you're like thinking of the branded stuff, you missed the guys who lined up at, you missed the part where you're lined up at 7 a.m. But you know, when the store opens at 9, 10 a.m., the sale is still there. I mean, our market's still at 6,000. We haven't really gone anywhere in the past 5 years. Many stocks are trading 60-70% below their previous highs, and these are high quality stocks. So I don't think they've missed the boat. It's a function of just having a well diversified portfolio and sticking to those with fortress balance sheets and solid fundamentals.
Fortress balance sheet. I like the sound of that.
Because we want to buy something that'll be there next year.
Exactly. Okay, let's go over some interesting corporate stories now. A big one from Pilipinas Shell. Pilipinas
yeah.
Shell has decided to permanently shut down the refinery
yeah.
operations. I know at the start of this year, they were like, we're going to temporarily close and then reopen when the
yes,
market conditions
yes.
improve. But now they're saying, no, we're just going to shut it down. What is the
yeah,
implication of this?
Yeah, that goes to show you that refining margins have dropped significantly, and with gasoline demand falling because of all the lockdowns, it became untenable for them to refine, such that it's actually cheaper for them to just import. But again, it's very surprising for them to shut down such a significant operation, and they even said permanent. So just that goes to show you how difficult the business environment is for certain sectors.
Would Shell...
And they also canceled their dividend, by the way.
Exactly. I was going to say that that's not a very good sign. But this shutting down of the refining operations, it sounds pretty permanent for a pandemic that we all expect to be temporary.
Unless they're taking a view that oil demand will stay low, such that refining spreads will also stay low.
Huh. Okay.
So they made a view. They took a view on that.
Mm-hmm.
And they would know that better than I would.
Okay, another interesting corporate story, Megaworld, posting 34% drop in its first half net income to just $5.9 billion. Although for those who are going to look through their papers, this is not yet attributable to parent company, but the drop is 34% for the first half. But here's the bright spot there, that rental income actually grew by 10%, helping cushion the impact of the pandemic. Quick take on this.
Well, office will do better than condos, but as you can see, reservation sales in the second quarter were practically obliterated. So I don't know how long it will take for demand for that to come back. But recurring income will likely do better than, say, residential sales in the near term.
Mm-hmm. And how about Cebu Pacific? Cebu Air also posting a second quarter net loss of about $7.96 billion. Not exactly a surprise, huh?
Yeah, that's not surprising, but it looks like they're all their cost cutting. Mm-hmm. They put some aircraft into storage. So a lot of companies are going into survival mode. Mm-hmm. Which is why it's important that they have balance sheet leeway so that they can get through the winter.
For companies that go on survival mode and for investors looking at these companies, this is good, right?
It's a good thing if it depends, because you want to cut costs in order to survive, but you don't want to cut too much such that when the market turns around, when there's a vaccine or something like that, you're not able to get back market share. So I'd look at it on a case-to-case basis. But by and large, the ones we mentioned seem to be doing the right thing.
Mm-hmm. How about this? Solaire Resort and Casino operator Enrique Dazon's Bloomberry also posting a second quarter net loss of $4.7 billion, but at least it did still pretty okay in the first quarter, so net loss for the first half is not as big. Also not surprising.
If people are afraid to go out, what more, and they want to save money, what more gamble it away? But yeah, that's going to come back at some point because there's really some people who love gambling. Mm-hmm. I think when the environment really gets closer to normal, you're going to see a rebound there. But it's really hard to say when. Mm-hmm. So they've got to rely more on the mass market local here than, say, foreign junkets because of the restrictions on air travel. Mm-hmm. So there's going to be a recovery there. We don't know when, but I think investors are looking forward to 2021 and just writing off whatever's happening in 2020 so that whenever you see companies report bad earnings, unless there's like an escalation of the existential crisis, the stock doesn't get as punished anymore.
Mm-hmm. How about this? Rojas Holdings says that the sale of its sugar mill and other assets to URC will help it trim its debt levels.
So what it's doing there is just like cash is king right now because you're trying to sort of survive this environment. So they're just selling what assets they can to willing buyers in order to cut the debt. Because if your operations are slowing down and you're having cash burn on interest expense, it's really best to cut that down first before cutting other costs. Mm-hmm. I particularly like URC. They've got, 15, close to $20 billion in cash. So, and they had very good earnings in 2Q. Beat analyst expectations, up more than 20%. I think URC has ammunition.
Okay, URC has ammunition. Let's talk about the MSCI rebalancing, Miguel. The results are out of some companies. I think we have a list of which companies in the MSCI rebalancing are getting upgraded and downgraded. I hope we could show those lists, but there you go.
Negligible.
Okay, but some are expecting about $70 million in foreign funds outflows because of this. These changes, these moves.
But it's not going to be as significant as the other MSCI rebalances where you see like $10 billion, $5 billion. On the last day. So we don't anticipate a very significant move from this. As you can see on the screen, they're like second decimal place move.
Okay. And here's one interesting foreign news. A big one from abroad. The world's most valuable automaker, Tesla, splits its stock in a 5-for-1 exchange to make lofty shares attainable again. Is this a good thing? And do we do that here? I've never heard of it ever since I started covering the stock market.
Reverse splits are really, they really do nothing for fundamentals, okay? Mm-hmm. They basically increase the number of shares by, say, 5 and divide the price by 5. So it's exactly the same thing. It's really to make it more accessible to retail investors who can't afford to buy one share. Although in the U.S., there's already purchase of fractional shares. So I think it's really just to make it more attractive to retail. here, there's also that belief that if the stock price is lower, the price is cheaper, which again, viewers, is not true. You should look at PE and net asset value. But again, it makes it attractive to those who have that view, and even to scalpers.
Okay, Miguel, I'm going to have to make this very quick. Blind item, sure. The stock that you like, very quickly.
Yeah. Okay, this is a mining company. I won't tell you its name. You know how mining companies have been, you know, have been underdogs for the past few years, but I think this one's going to make a rebound. It's probably the only mining company I know which is net cash. In fact, it declared a dividend of about 7%. Where we hear a mining company do that. If there's a recovery, if there's a vaccine, this is going to rebound fairly quickly, and it's still very.
Okay. On that note, thank you very much, Miguel, for joining us this morning.
Thank you, Mimi. Stay healthy.
You too.